wetness condition was previous to the condition was that for simplicity we have other results, but we have results with weaker conditions, but that was the easiest to assume that the Sij is of order 1 over n. The corresponding, the analog of that in terms of the superoperator is that whenever you take the SR for any non-negative operator R, you get a matrix. You get a positive and non-negative matrix, and this non-negative matrix has to be comparable with the trace of R. I mean, it's this bracket here just taking the normalized trace. So this is just a number, the normalized trace and the same normalized trace here with two different constants. And then the SR as a matrix has to be between these two constants, lower and upper bounded. So this is the right analog of that condition. So we assume that. And under this condition, we get basically everything what we had before. So we get that the density is compactly supported. We get Hölder continuity, but we didn't get the optimal one-third Hölder continuity. For that one needs extra conditions, which I don't want to discuss here. But under this condition, at least you get some kind of Hölder continuity. You get real analyticity away from the edge. And also you can get bounds on M and its inverse. The precise form of the bounds are not terribly important. These are the same type of the analogs, natural analogs, the similar bounds on the vector case. And most importantly, we know that the stability operator is bounded. So this was the stability operator over there. So its inverse is bounded in the natural norm. What is the natural norm? This is an operator which maps, which is defined in the space of matrices. And on the space of matrices, as we discussed, the natural norm is the Hilbert-Schmidt norm. So this operator here is the operator norm acting on the matrices equivalent with the Hilbert-Schmidt norm. It's a bit complicated, but if the space of matrices is equivalent with a norm, natural norm, then this norm naturally induces a norm on the space of operators acting on that space, and which I call the spectral norm here. And this guy in this norm is bounded again by something which is bounded as long as you are in the bulk, so as long as the density is away from zero, or you are far away from the bulk. And this power here, this 1,000 power is just not completely serious, it's just a constant, 1,000 would do. The optimal bound would be the 2, as in the previous case, but for that again you need further conditions. And this we didn't do yet. Okay, so let me try to indicate some proofs. So of course the main difficulty is that everything is non-commutative, unlike in the previous case. But nevertheless, I would try to mimic some of the ideas what we had in the proof before. And remember the key equation was also in the vector case is the equation what you get when you took the imaginary part of the equation itself. That led later on to an equation which revealed how this F operator looks like. So here you have to do the same thing, but already when you take the imaginary part of my equation, so it's this matrix equation, even when you take the imaginary part of the equation, you already have to watch out what the commutativity means. I mean, the imaginary part of 1 over m was just imaginary part of minus 1 over m as long as it's a complex number. It's just the imaginary part of m divided by m square. It's a triviality. But now if m is a matrix, then you have to be careful in which order you do things. And the right thing to do is this one. So it's even not... I'm trying to avoid taking the absolute value of the m. Should have said that. That typically m here is even not a normal matrix. It's not just not self-adjoint, even not a normal matrix. And if somebody is not a normal matrix, then even the absolute value is a little bit fishy. I mean, there are two ways to define the absolute values. Typically, either you take the mm star square root or m star m square root, but if it's not a normal matrix, these two things are not the same. You can decide for one, and if you look it up in any book which defines the absolute value of a matrix, usually they choose one of them, but they don't tell you that there's another choice, and there's always this ambiguity. So you have to try to avoid taking the m absolute value. Okay, so this is what you do. This is one way of doing it. And then, so this is the imaginary part on that side. And on the other side, you just take that's easier because the imaginary part, taking the imaginary part goes through the S operator, S is a linear operator. Okay, and now if you start studying this equation, then you can try to deduce similar bounds as before. So for example, the cheapest bound, which you get immediately, is that the S is a positivity preserving operator. Imagine part of M is positive, so this guy is positive. You can even neglect it as a lower bound. And then you get that the imaginary part of 1 over M is bigger than imaginary part of Z. And inverting that relation yields at least a trivial bound that the M is bounded by 1 over eta. We had the same bound before in the vector case as well. But of course, in general, you have to get something much better. Now, let me not go through the each of these estimates, but let me just emphasize or focus on one thing. The key question is that what is the proper analog of this operator F here? That's because if you remember, the huge part of the proof in the vector case relied on the fact that I created this F operator, and the F operator had good properties, much better properties than the S operator. It was bounded, it was self-adjoint, and so on. So how to do that? What is the right operator here? And so here is the goal. So the goal would be, with the help of this F operator, the goal would be to get an inverse, get some bound on the inverse of the stability operator. And the result is, I think it was already in previous transparency, so the claim is that the stability operator is invertible, at least as long as you are in the bulk. The key is to find this symmetrization. So here I just flashed up again, just to remind you what was done before in the vector case. In the vector case, we had the M, the solution, which a complex vector. We wrote up its polar decomposition, particularly there is the M absolute value, and out of this M absolute value, we created this F operator. This would be like M absolute value S, M absolute value sandwiching in between, and then we have seen that the 1 minus M S square is basically the same as this F operator minus the e to the minus 2 alpha. So this is summarizing what I did on this blackboard here. And now, what did we need about F? So F had two good properties. I already emphasized that one of them is that it had to be symmetric, because at the end of the day, we drew the spectrum, and it was useful, it was very important that the F had a real spectrum. So we needed that F is symmetric. This was needed when we did the spectral analysis, but it also needed that it's positivity preserving, because positivity preserving was needed for the Perron-Frobenius argument. So F had these two good properties, it's even written here. And now we would like to mimic we would like to find a corresponding F in the matrix case. But in the matrix case, this F will be one level higher, because now I'm talking about an operator which acts on matrices. So and then my new F will be on the same level as this S operator, this script or calligraphic S operator. It has to act on matrices. So it has to be self-adjoint with respect to the Hilbert-Schmidt scalar product. That's the analog of the symmetry, and it has to be positivity preserving in a sense that if you feed in a positive matrix, then the outcome should be a positive matrix. Okay, and here is just reminding you this formula. When I took the imaginary part of this equation, then and I appropriately reorganized it, then this operator is MSM operator sort of popped up. So now let me try to do this in the matrix case. So let me do it on the blackboard, because then you see it slower, at least at the beginning. So I take the imaginary part of that equation, which I already took before. So imaginary part of M. And when you took the imaginary part, then you got the, it was here, somewhere that was the imaginary part of M, so it was sandwiched between 1 over M star and M. But then I can multiply through by M star from one side and M on the other side. So I write up the equation in that form. So let me write it up here. It's eta M star M plus M star S imaginary part M M. Okay, so that's the imaginary part of the equation. Let me forget about that part, this I will not follow, because this term is helping me, it's a positive term, but eta is tiny and it doesn't help much. But now I would like to do something like the polar decomposition here, because in order to do this F operator, I have to smuggle in the M absolute value. So what I will do, but I don't know what the M absolute value is. That's the problem. And also I know that even if I knew it, I have to be careful on which side I put it, because this is non-commutative. So what I will do here, I take a matrix Q, which I don't know yet. I just assume that there will be a matrix Q, and I play with it. The intuition is that the Q absolute value will be something like the 1 over square root of M. But this doesn't quite make sense as it stands, but this is the intuition. That's what you should keep in mind. Okay, so now I take this 1 over Q and Q star and multiply from both sides this equation. So this is that. So again, the 1 over Q plays the role of the 1 over square root of M. So this guy here all together will be the analog of imaginary part of M divided by M absolute value in this guy, in this side. But this dividing by 1 over M absolute value, I have to divide into two parts, one on the left, square root of that on the left, and the square root of that on the right. And this is what this Q will mimic at the end. Okay, so now let me rewrite this term here. That term I neglect, so not so important. So now I have the 1 over Q, because I multiply the equation by 1 over Q and 1 over Q star from the two sides. Then I have the M star, so I'm just follow my hands, multiplied by 1 over Q from the left. Now, but I don't like something which looks like 1 over Q times M star. I want to get everything in a symmetric way. So the right way to make it symmetric, I smuggle in the 1 over Q star at that point, but then I have to compensate for that. It becomes a Q star. Okay, now I have this S. And in the argument of F, I have the imaginary part of M. But remember that the previous trick was here also, that the argument of S was the imaginary part of M. But I wanted to see the imaginary part of M over M. And it is the same guy in the argument of S as it on the right-hand side. So on the left-hand side. So on the left-hand side, I have this guy. But originally I have only the S acting on the imaginary part of M. So I smuggle in the 1 over Q, imaginary part of M, and 1 over Q star on both sides. But then the price that I pay for it, I have to compensate. So again, I divide and multiply. It looks like I'm not doing anything. And then on the other side, I will multiply the whole thing by the 1 over Q star. That will hit the M. 1 over Q star. But again, I don't like something looking at asymmetric. So I smuggle in the 1 over Q and the Q. Yes, I didn't do anything. It's just an identity. But I claim that it looks much nicer than before. You may not agree, but that's the fact. This one looks much nicer, because now I should think of it in the following way, that there is this operator, this part, which goes up only, so the operator which looks like Q star S Q, acting on something in the middle, and then Q star and Q. So now what are these somethings? So let me call this guy X, just so that you can see a little bit better what happens. So let me call this X, and then let me call this guy Y. These two operators. This was the Y. This is the Y, so Q, Q. That's the Y, sorry. This is the Y, and this is the Y star. I just defined the 1 over Q and 1 over Q star to be the Y. That's here. And then on the other side, I see the star of the Y. Okay, so now with these notations, the equation looks like that X equals Y star. And now here you have this operator, but the operator is this Q star S Q, and on the other side you have Q star Q. So this operator will be our F operator. Write it up in a minute. And this F operator acts on the guy in the middle, and then you have the Y outside, where the F is defined exactly as this formula tells, that F on any matrix R is defined just by taking the Q star S Q R Q star Q. So read it in a right way. take a matrix R, first you put it here, you sandwich it between Q and U star, you get another matrix, you let this S operator, the super operator, act on that matrix, you get a matrix, and then you sandwich this matrix again by Q and Q star, but now in the opposite order. Okay, so this is the definition of F. And with this definition, we got this equation. Now, you can see immediately that this F operator is a good operator because of the proper way of putting the stars in the right place. You can immediately see that this operator is actually a symmetric operator with respect to the scalar product. And it's also positivity preserving. You know, once I tell you the formula, then it's not hard to check these properties. But the key was to get this formula. Okay, now, but what do I do with the rest? So this is now my equation looks like that. But it's still not exactly in the form what I like. Remember, I would like to get a Perron-Frobenius type equation. So I would like to get an equation that f acting on the operator is exactly, that x is an eigenvalue, eigenmatrix in that case of that operator. So if these y's were not there, I would be happier. Then it would be exactly a Perron-Frobenius-like eigenvalue equation. So I have to get that. But fortunately, I can do it if this y has some additional property. And notice, first of all, that x and y are, of course, not unrelated to each other. So this is the x, this is the y. And then the only difference between the x and the y, that in the x, there's an imaginary part. So actually, the x is the imaginary part of y. Just by the formula, and now I don't want this y and y star on that side on here. Of course, I can put it on the other side. I can put the y star inverse and the y inverse over there. That doesn't help much. But if y were unitary, then you could feel that this y and y star should cancel each other, not on that side, it's rather on the other side. They would cancel each other if they were commuting with x. But in general, it's not true. But it's true in this situation. So the fact is that if y is unitary, y is unitary, then in particular it commutes with its own imaginary part. That's an easy check. Then x and y commute. So if y is unitary, then you can put the y's on the other side, and then you can commute through the x, so the y disappears. And then the equation would be exactly what I want. Okay? And that's exactly this Perron-Frobenius type equation from which you would conclude, among many other things, you would conclude that the norm of F in this spectral norm is bounded by 1, as before. And then the whole Perron-Frobenius machinery would work. Okay, so now that's the goal. So I would like to, so this will be my F operator, but I still have to get this if. And of course, I also don't, I didn't tell you what the Q is. You see, the Q is just a dummy object in this whole calculation so far. Okay, but let me just finish how one does the proof, and then at the end I will show you the Q operator. So once you have that, once you believe that there is such a good Q operator, then you can also rewrite, you can do the same calculation as before. You can rewrite the stability operator, which is basically this MSM operator, just this guy here. You can rewrite it in terms of the F operator. And let me not go through the calculation details, it's just an identity, it's the same type of trick. You keep on smuggling in and out these Qs. So this calculation here, it's basically the analog of this calculation before, which was much more visible when you had the stability operator. And you wrote the stability operator in terms of the F minus a unitary, and then sandwiched by something harmless on both sides. It's the same calculation you can do here. Here is the stability operator, and it becomes something which involves the F operator on that side, or maybe the next line is easier to see. So altogether, you can write a stability operator in such a way that you have some decoration on the two sides. This is now this operator k of q, which is a, which is operating on a space of matrices, it operates in this sandwiching way. That's not important. These two sides are not important. The important thing is the middle one, and the middle one is exactly this identity minus a unitary times the f. This cy is the sandwiching operator with the y, and if y was unitary as a matrix, then the operation of sandwiching with the y is also a unitary operation on one level higher. So altogether, you will get stability if this guy is stable, and all we need, and then studying this guy basically goes back to the previous statement, stability lemma, which is a self-adjoint operator times a unitary operator, and invert one minus of that. So all we need for that is we need to find what this q is. So once more, what we need, it was assumed here, rather here, it was assumed that there is a q and a y in such a way that I can write a 1 over q and 1 over q star as a y which is unitary. So in other words, what was assumed, we used that the m, I'm just reading this line here in a different way, so the m is written like qy q star, and this guy here in the middle had to be unitary. So now what is that? This looks like a polar decomposition. The typical polar decomposition gives you any matrix, and you write it like an absolute value times a unitary. Now, as I already said before, if it's a non-normal matrix, then the absolute value is not unique. So you can write you can have a polar decomposition such that it's absolute value times a unitary. You can write it the other way around, that a unitary times an absolute value, but the two absolute values are not the same. So it's obvious that the standard polar decomposition has some kind of arbitrariness in it. It's not symmetric. Now, this guy here is much more symmetric. The unitary is in the middle. And the q here should be thought of as the square root of the absolute value, if it had existed. Okay, so this is what we are after. And once you know what you are after, you can do it fairly easily. So we don't do it for every matrix M. Our M matrix has a good property, so this is the goal here. But our M matrix has a good property, it has positive imaginary part. So what we do is that, just write up one more line from that. So M has positive imaginary part. So you write M in such a way that it's A plus IB. Okay, so A is the real part, B is the imaginary part of that matrix. But now I continue this writing in such a way that I pull out the square root of B. B is the imaginary part of M, which is a self-adjoint. It's a positive operator, so its square root exists. There's no ambiguity about the square root of a positive operator. So I take the square root of that, and then I compensate for that, b 1 over square root of b plus I, square root of b. This is just an identity. Okay? I'm just smuggling in and out things. Now, this middle factor here is now a good guy. What is this guy? This guy, of course, a and b, these are Hermitian objects. So this guy here, 1 over square root of b, a is 1 over square root of b, is a Hermitian matrix plus I. So this whole thing here is a normal matrix. It's a self-adjoint plus an I. It's a very simple object. So I would like to write M in such a way, something, a unitary times something else. So this guy in the middle, it looks like a good candidate for the Y, except that it's not unitary yet. But I can make it unitary by dividing it by its length. And that's what I'm doing. That's what I'm doing next. So I'm defining the length of that object, or rather the square of that. So I take I define the W as the length of that operator, or rather the square root of that, so 1 over B, 1 over B square plus 1. This would be the length of that operator, but I take the one quarter of that in such a way that now the W square is exactly the length of that, and now I divide through by that. So this is this guy here. So this becomes that, a1 over b plus I divided by w square. So this guy here will be my y. This is unitary. And then whatever is left, I just collect on both sides. WW and then square root of B and square root of B. And this will be my guy. So this will be the Y and this will be the Q. Okay, so in that way you can check the properties. So this gives me this polar decomposition, this symmetrized polar decomposition. And if you know that B is which an imaginary part is bounded away from zero and from above, and A is also bounded, then you can check that this Q operator, which is now written explicitly, it's really an order one operator in a sense that its norm and its norm inverse is also bounded. So this will make sure that all these sandwiching operators which are hanging around, so taking 1 over Q and Q, that all these operations are harmless as far as the invertibility is concerned. Everything boils down to the invertibility of this guy as before. And for the invertibility of that guy, just again rewrote it in another way, the invertibility of that guy is basically can be done exactly the same way as previously I mentioned this lemma, the stability lemma, because now it was formulated in a Hilbert space contact. This Hilbert space doesn't have to be my original n-dimensional CN space. It can be the space of matrices, of n by matrices, equipped with the Hilbert-Schmidt norm, and in that setup the lemma looks exactly the same as before. Of course, one has to check that the superoperator also has a gap, and also I have to check what happens to the only critical eigenvector, which here it's actually not an eigenvector but an eigenmatrix, because it's a superoperator acting on matrices. It's an eigenmatrix, which is this Roman F, and you have to check that this guy here is separated away from zero. Okay, so that's roughly what you do. And once you have that, then you can basically go back to the previous scheme. So here is finally our statement. So if you have the back to the correlated random matrices, I think the theorem I already put it up there before. So this theorem is that the resolvent is approximated by the M, the solution of this matrix Dyson equation, both in entry-wise sense, so GXY is close to MXY, and also in trace sense. And typically M is not diagonal because G, that's a general equation, and also G has non-trivial of diagonal components. So this is the general setup when the matrix does not, the resolvent does not reduce the diagonal case. So let me not discuss, this part I already explained that once you have the original, once you have the equation, the self-consistent equation, then you write up an equation for the resolvent, which is a small perturbation of that, and then using the stability you can get a good bound on G minus M in terms of the size of D. So let me just summarize in this little table. So we have studied various models of various generality, and in this table you see the models. There were 4 models. There was the original Wigner case when Sij was 1 over N. There was a generalized Wigner case when the rho sum was 1. There was a Wigner type case when the Sij was arbitrary, but it was still, the matrix elements were still independent. And then there was this more general case, the correlated Wigner, the correlated situation. Here you see the Dyson equations. They all look the same, but the meaning of the terms is getting more and more complicated. Here the M is a scalar. Here the M is a vector, and here the M is a matrix. So there is a scalar equation, a vector equation, and a matrix equation. And then here the equation, I put it what the meaning of M is in terms of random matrices, and here are the stability operators. So everything looks the same, but every line, the next line is one level higher as the previous one. And what I would like to close the session with is that to emphasize that it looks like that the correlated Wigner matrix is the only one which needs matrix equations. So far one could get away with the vector equations, but this is not really the right point of view. The right point of view is that the matrix equation is the true object. This last one is the true object, because eventually you really want to understand the resolvent, and the resolvent itself is a matrix. So this last one, the matrix equation, is the good object, and in some cases, some simpler models, it can happen that the matrix equation is restricted to a diagonal matrix, everything becomes diagonal matrix, and then, of course, if you have a diagonal matrix, you don't want to describe it as a matrix, you just describe it as a vector in the diagonals. And if you have the diagonal matrix as a constant matrix, then you forget about even that it was a vector, then it goes back to a scalar level. But the basic object is always a matrix behind it. There's a matrix hanging around behind all these things. So I'm not going to do any recapitulation. Let me just come to the summary. So we reviewed the local laws for various random matrix ensembles in increasing generality, I discussed before. I gave a quantitative analysis of the solution of the matrix Dyson equation, especially its stability. I emphasize again that the matrix Dyson equation is the correct equation in random matrix theory. It has many, many applications. Here I just showed the application for the correlated case. But actually, if you take many other situations, for example, you take Gram matrices or inhomogeneous circular law, you take non-Hermitian matrices, you do the Gierkos formula, Gierkos trick, you hermitize, and you do the Gierkos trick, or you can do some structured matrices, some block matrices, and everything. All these models can be cast into the framework of the matrix equation. If you do that, then you can see, then suddenly this nice structure emerges much easier. So sometimes it's worse to rewrite a simpler problem into a more complicated matrix problem because the structure reveals itself. And then for the concrete case, the correlated random matrices with slow correlation decay, we eventually proved the optimal local law and all these consequences, which is the Wigner-Dyson meta universality. Okay, so thanks for the attention. Everything else is in the notes.
Is there maybe one quick question?
Could you handle general Wigner matrices with independent entries and non-centered matrices?
Yes, everything is non-centered here. Actually, this was, I'm not sure if I put it somewhere. I think at the very beginning I still put an A in it, but then I removed it. Yeah, there was an A here. This was in the vector case. That's the expectation here. The same thing we can do also for the matrix level. I didn't put it in, but the equation disappeared. But if you have a vector, so if you have a Z plus A plus SM, so this A stands for the expectation. You can do that as actually Torben explained this better in the previous talk. So you can include expectation. I mean, certain answers will differ a little bit. I mean, some of the bounds don't look exactly the same, but you can. But the final results will hold. So we have local law, we have universality, everything with a general expectation. Yes. For simplicity, I didn't put it in this discussion, but we can do that.
Okay, maybe we should leave other questions for lunch and let's thank Laszlo for his nice lecture as well.